All right. How's everyone doing this morning?
Perfect.
Awesome. So my name is Greg Donnelly. I am Assistant Vice President for Economic Development at Wayne State University and Chief Strategy Officer here at Tech Town Detroit. I have the pleasure of welcoming you to the first ever Leaders Connect here in Detroit. So I'd actually like to thank the team, first of all, Rod Pasick, the folks from Bank of Ann Arbor. If we could give them a round of applause for bringing this here to Detroit. We'll hear more from all of them in a couple of moments, and then of course from Ari Weinzweig as well. But first I wanted to tell you a little bit about where you are. Tech Town is Detroit's hub for innovation. This is where opportunity happens. This building is about 130,000 square feet, and our work really happens in three areas. So the building itself, we have five floors of tenants, ranging from folks that have an entire floor to a suite, to a small private office, and then our co-working space that you just walked through on your way into this room today. We have 140 members in our co-working space, and then all this event space here that this room included, of course. So if you're looking to do business in Detroit, we have something for you here in this building. We also do programs that really face outward for tech-based entrepreneurs. So we actually incubate tech-based businesses here. And we also run a program called Detroit Technology Exchange that works with college students and recent grads to help them build their tech businesses through a summer program. That's actually an accelerator, and they get paid. Rather than having to find some other summer job, they get to work on their ideas and get paid for it here at Tech Town over the summer. And then finally, we have our neighborhood-based programs. We're working in six different geographies around town with bricks and mortar, storefront, commercial buildings, businesses that are in commercial storefronts, helping them to grow their businesses in Detroit. So there's a lot going on here. It's that really intersection of all of those things that makes this place work. We've been here for about 15 years, started in partnership with General Motors, Wayne State University, and Henry Ford Health System. So the way this works with the Leaders Connect events is that you have a main speaker and a great conversation with that person, but you start off by hearing from a local nonprofit partner. These events are free, open to anyone that would like to come and attend. But we ask that you really consider supporting the great work of that nonprofit. Today's nonprofit is Forgotten Harvest, and my friend Kirk Mays here is the president and CEO, and he's going to tell you about their work.
Good morning, everybody. Well, it is a privilege and an honor for me to stand here this morning in front of you and tell you a little bit about Forgotten Harvest. I'd like to say thank you to Rob for not only putting on this event for many, many years, I hear now almost two decades of putting this on, and then this being the first time in Detroit, it's making it even more of an honor to be here for the first time in front of you as the nonprofit partner this time around. Forgotten Harvest, of course, is a local Metro Detroit nonprofit organization. It's 26 years old, started by a woman by the name of Nancy Fishman in a time period when she was actually going through a transition in her life. She was actually going through a marriage transition, and she found herself with her kids in a tough situation where she needed to rely on the services of a local food distribution organization, like a food kitchen or soup kitchen. Nancy grew up in a situation where she went in a lifestyle, in a home environment where struggle was not a common thing for her. So that event, that phenomenon of her life situation, she was pretty conscious that her life would turn around. Things would get better at a point. And even in that moment, she had the consciousness and wherewithal to look around the room where she was and realize that the people that she was in there with didn't have probably the same circumstances that she was going to be able to walk into when she got done. So in that moment, Nancy actually made a commitment that when her life did come around, when it did turn around, she's going to do something to give back, and give back specifically in a way that would actually affect the mothers that she saw in those lines with children standing right next to them. So when Nancy got a chance, when her life started to stabilize, she started doing some research, and she found stories about people who were going around identifying places that had fresh food that was going to waste. From everything from the idea of dumpster diving to the bent box that everybody's wondering, what's really wrong with this other than this just being a bent box? Is everything inside still good? The leftovers from your caterer, when you know there was 10 pans of chicken that were ordered, but we only ate eight, Well, the caterer can't do anything with that with their next client, and they're typically not taking it home to their families. So in the United States of America, we have 70 billion pounds of food that's wasted in our country. 45% of the food that's even produced for us in the United States of America never hits the store shelf and definitely never gets to our kitchen tables. When that food does go to waste, I'm talking about good food. I'm not talking about the stuff you don't want anymore. I'm not even talking about stuff that if you saw it somewhere, that somebody was selling it, you would walk past it. You would probably want it, and you would probably pay a good dollar or two for it. Currency, not a dollar or two. All right? And what's happening is when that stuff goes into a trash can or a dumpster and it ends up in a landfill, as it decomposes, it releases naturally gas. That methane gas that it releases actually is 26 to 32 times more dangerous, has more of an effect as a greenhouse gas on our environment than your carbon emissions out of your car. The difference between the two is that the methane gas has a shorter life cycle, so it doesn't have as much of a long-term effect, but we're not here for a science class. The basics of it is, how many places can you go? How many places can you find? How many organizations can you find? And I'm sure there are some, I'm sure there are probably many. But for sure, let me tell you about one that actually goes around every day, 6 days a week, and prevents something really bad from happening. And with that same energy, that same product from that, we actually take that and then we find people in our community, organizations within Wayne, Oakland, Macomb County, and we get that food to organizations that serve people, and they then get that food out to our local community. Last year, Forgotten Harvest was able to save and distribute 42.3 million pounds of food in Wayne, Oakland, Macomb County. Nobody's counting, really, except us. But that makes us one of the nation's most significant impactors in this space. But actually, we rank in the world as one of the nation's, or the, one of the world's most productive and most effective nonprofits that are doing food rescue, preventing food and getting out to people in need. So it is absolutely my honor to have been the CEO for Forgotten Harvest for 2 years. It started with one person who had a conviction, a willingness, and a belief that she can make a change. And today, that one person with a Jeep is now a staff of 80 people, 34 refrigerated trucks, a 30,000 square foot warehouse, and we're continuing to work every day to become better for our community so we can continue to move that change on. We believe in people, we believe in this work, and we know how important that is for our future. You're here to see Ari, that's all I got. It's fashion comes first.
Well, good morning, everybody. Thanks for coming out. My name is Michael Cole. I'm with the Bank of Ann Arbor. I've been involved in getting and bringing this Leaders Connect program to Detroit from Ann Arbor, where we've been holding it for a number of years with Rob Pasick. And I get the honor this morning not only to welcome you guys, but to introduce Rob. Rob's got a new book. I think it's his eighth book. This is his new book. If you put business cards out front, we're going to be giving away a few copies of this book at the end, as well as a few copies of Ari's book. last year, I graduated from also the Leadership Detroit program. And so bringing this, and a couple of classmates are here from the class of 36.
36.
And part of that program is, bringing this program to Detroit was a little bit of an outgrowth of kind of one of the assignments of coming out of that program. So real privilege to be able to be involved with that. It's taken us about a year to get it all together, but we've got a good crowd today, and I think you'll enjoy the program. So I'm going to introduce Rob here. Rob's a born and raised in Detroit, big Detroit Tigers fan. Since earning his PhD in clinical psychology and public practice from Harvard University, Rob's provided leadership development services through teaching, coaching, speaking, and writing. He's the president and founder of Leaders Connect and CEO Connect, which are leadership development and networking programs for executives and entrepreneurs. Rob's clients range from Fortune 500 executives, from all over the world to men and women starting their own businesses and stepping into their first professional careers. He's an adjunct professor at the Ross School of Business at the University of Michigan. I think he started out teaching elementary school in Harlem. He's made many public appearances on radio and TV, including Oprah, his big claim to fame, as well as the Today Show, NPR, and CNN. As an author, as I mentioned, he has 8 books. This is his most recent book, Self-Aware, A Guide for Success in Work and Life. So I will bring on Rob Pasick.
It's a pleasure to be here, to see all these, some familiar faces, some Detroit faces. We got some cool companies and some really cool enterprises, ideas coming out of Detroit and Ann Arbor. And one of the ideas that we had about bringing this program east is that actually Detroit is too small and Ann Arbor is too small. And Jackson is too small, and Grand Rapids is too small for us to really be significant players on the global economy. What we're getting is megatropolises. We're getting these huge areas all through the world that are hubs for business. And if we don't develop the I-94 corridor, we're missing a great opportunity to be able to do that. So I envision all the way actually from Windsor, through Detroit, through the airport, which is beginning to finally take hold in terms of a hub for enterprise with the new tunnel coming in, going out to Ipsy, let's not forget Ipsy, very dynamic, very old community, Detroit, Jackson, and right on through the state. And then you could go up to East Lansing if you want, but that's okay. Actually, Detroit is probably, how many MSU fans do we have? Yeah, and how many Michigan fans do we have? Oh, I think that's probably about the score of the game that's going to be. I'd be happy with a 1-point victory. So, actually, I had the pleasure this year of teaching 5 of the Michigan starters, and one of the former Michigan starters, Vince Smith, is sitting right here. Vince, you can say hi. I've been telling Vince you ought to charge for selfies, but he's more concerned about his nonprofit, which is called Team Gardens. So if you guys ought to have a conversation, he's doing some great work in Flint now. But I want to thank the people who made this possible. Mike Durkas is in front. Mike is, what's your name, the name of the company, Mike?
The Hunter Group.
The Hunter Group, which is
Executive Search.
Ferris Alami could not be here, but one of his associates is here. Where is the associate? I'm not seeing, I'm sorry.
Checking people in.
She's checking people in. So Ferris has got an international consulting company. He's happens to be in Dubai today. You know, it's like, where is everybody? My wife happens to be in Rwanda today. She's coming back from work there that she does for her nonprofit. So we're becoming a really global world. And of course, Bank of Ann Arbor has been a tremendous sponsor, not only for this activity, but for anybody ever go to Sonic Lunch in Ann Arbor? And great music. Mike can actually play a little guitar himself, but that's not your dream.
Harmonica,
I'm sorry. And I want to thank Zingtrain. Zingtrain, it's interesting, when I met Ari, it's probably 35 years ago, he was just opening up a little storefront in Ann Arbor that had been kind of an old grocery store. And he introduced me to his partner at the time, Maggie Bayless, who now is the managing director of, or whatever the exact title is,
partner,
of Zing,
managing
partner of Zingtrain. So Zingtrain sponsors a lot of education about and training in the area of doing great business and doing business that's fun, doing great customer service. And they're one of our sponsors today. Do you all enjoy the food so far? Yeah, all right, well, that's another Zingerman's company, Zingerman's Bakehouse. And Frank Carolla, one of the founders there, donated 100 pieces of pastries, delicious pastries. I see, Jeff, you're munching on one now, as we speak. And then we call...
He's never had it before.
And then when we hit 140 signups for today, we thought, well, we better go purchase some more food to be sure that we feed this hungry crowd. And Frank said, hey, I don't want you to buy anything. We're going to donate the rest of it, too. So he wants us to succeed. So a lot of people are really happy to have this succeed. And I personally feel quite touched by it because after I graduated from Ferndale High School in 1964, I used to drive down 2nd Avenue, or which way is 2nd going? 2nd going south or north, I forget. One went north, one went south. And to Wayne State, which is my first college experience. And I went there for my freshman year. So it would be very surprising. I was studying something like engineering and math, pre-doc, you know, which I lasted one course in, where I realized that was not my strength. And hopefully I could find something else. And but here I'm back in Detroit. It's my hometown, and I'm really happy to see what's going on downtown Detroit. We still have a lot of work to do throughout the area. So this is Leaders Connect, and we do a lot with connecting, but we don't have a lot of time to start with. But I do some fun stuff about connecting. And at 9:30, when Ari is done, I hope some of you could stay because I'm going to. I studied improv theater, and I really enjoy finding unique ways to get people to get to meet each other. So I brought a little toy along that's going to help us, and it's a connect toy, not anything else that, you know, it's just I use it with my granddaughter and with my classes at U of M. And I thought we could do a kind of a fast way to connect with each other. So please stay at 9:30 if you can, and we'll do this so that the goal is not only to be enlightened and entertained and energized by Ari. It's pretty good, Ari. Three E's. I like to use that. Enlightened. Yes, yes. And but also to go away with meeting some new people. And it, you know, one action thing that I'd like to see happen is that as a result of coming today, you're going to pick up the phone, not actually, or maybe your text or whatever, and say, hey, let's meet for coffee. You know, let's get together. I met Christine Steed a few years ago. We did that. We met at a networking event in Ann Arbor. We've become friends. Just by following up from a networking event, let's have coffee. How can we help each other? And so there's a lot of ways that we can do that. And so I know there's a lot of people I could introduce. I know a lot of you in the audience. One piece of person I want to definitely introduce is Dunry Greiling. Dunry, raise your hand. Dunry was instrumental in getting my book out this year. But the book, we started thinking about getting this book into book print form in about April, and it's in your hands today. And it's amazing how she helped edit it and construct it, conceive it, and we're excited about where it's going to go. It's really a based on the curriculum that I've developed through coaching and all through teaching several hundred undergraduate and graduate students at the University of Michigan about interpersonal relationships. Have you ever had to stand in front of a class of 50 students who are in engineering and say, at the end of this class, you're going to be able to talk about yourself. You're going to know yourself a lot. But that's a daunting task, but it's worked out pretty well. So I mentioned that 35 years ago, so I walked into this place called Zingerman's Deli, and it was a little corner spot on Detroit Street there, right from near the farmer's market. And that time, Carytown was just kind of getting started. It wasn't really a whole lot there. I thought, well, this is kind of cool, because when we moved to Ann Arbor, my wife and I met in Ann Arbor in the 60s, but then we moved back in the 70s. And there were like 3 Chinese restaurants, 4 German restaurants. That was about it. I think a couple like steakhouses maybe. But there was no Jewish food. We had lived in New York and Boston. And there was no deli, and really not much quality in the way of food. We've seen a tremendous resurgence of food in the region. And there was also nothing that I would say in Ann Arbor that you'd write home about in terms of customer service. But over the 35 years that Zingerman's has been in business, they have brought food, and not just regular food, but I'd call it like peasant food, food that people eat on the streets wherever you go. They bought this quality food, best ingredients, now locally grown, much of it, to our awareness and to our palates. They've also really set the bar very high and set the standard for customer service. I don't know about you, but after being in Zingerman's, I'm awfully impatient with any bad customer service. I mean, do you find that? It's just like you go in a place and like, really? You're going to look at me cross-eyed because my soup is cold? You know, I mean, as opposed to bringing me a free dessert or whatever they do. And the customer is always right at Zingerman's, and they always make it right for you and make help you understand. So that's been a great part of Ari and Paul Saginaw's service to our community, but also the service itself has been amazing. You talked about Forgotten Harvest. They started food gatherers shortly after they opened, gathering food in Ann Arbor to redistribute. And whatever is worthwhile in Ann Arbor, you see Zingerman's is behind it. And they treat their employees unbelievably. Sylvia Van Burton is here. Where did you work in Zingerman's?
I worked for Zingerman's when I was a teenager. I went to community high school, and I applied to work at Zingerman's Produce. You guys remember that when I was in Carytown? And I had a shaved head, a nose ring, and they were like, welcome to the family. Maybe you should be the manager, after a few months. And it was one of the first places anyone had taken me seriously based on my effort and not my like demographic. And it changed my whole work life.
And I think you could hear stories like Sylvia's from really probably 1,000 people at least that either are still working there or have worked there and had their lives changed by that experience. Ari saw Sylvia today. He said, hey, anytime you want a job, you're welcome back. It's been, 20 years, you know, so.
You have a lot of jobs.
Do you? That's good.
We know.
Yeah. So without any further ado, because Ari gets embarrassed and I hate to see him blush, I want to bring up my good friend, Ari Weinzweig. Oh, I just want to mention one other thing. He's going to be talking about this event also at a dinner on October 5th at Zing Roadhouse, which is where we usually hold these events. So if you want to hear talk about his philosophy of food, his beliefs about food, and have an amazing dinner October 5th at the Roadhouse.
It's not like a tangible thing, it's sort of just like a feeling, more or less.
I think it can mean very many different things.
It kind of can morph into whatever you need it to be for, but it would never mean jerky.
It would never mean jerky, no.
I think it's a place where people eat. I think it's a place where we want people to eat, but I think it's also a place where we want people to have fun.
It's an experience. It's great food, it's great service, it's great finance, it's giving back to the community, and it's all based around a love of food and service. And it kind of has this synergy going in a life of its own and just keeps getting better and better.
Well, physically, it's a community of businesses. There's 8 businesses now, and they're all based in Ann Arbor, and they're food producing and or selling businesses. Not physically, I think it's a culture.
We are a community of businesses, and I really like that because we're not legally bound as a community. We're a community by choice. And that, you know, I mean, to me, that does embody it, that we're all making the choice to be a part of this organization, and that this organization is making a choice to be an organization, that we're 8 different businesses, but we choose to operate in a way that is not like any other business that I've ever known.
There's not enough words to describe Zingerman's, not only the food and the taste of the food, but the way that people are treated, both customers and employees alike. It's the way that the business runs on its own with systems just in place to make everything happen and happen the way that it should happen.
It's a lifestyle. They give us the tools to both learn about the food, to live the food, to love the food, but they also connect us with people and connect us with the resources to be not only successful but to thrive in the community. I mean, they give us so much more than any other business I've been able to work for. They pay me like they respect me. My managers talk to me and always give me the recognition like they respect me. My coworkers, I love seeing them every day. I love working for a place that loves having me work there.
They encourage me to be me. In order to get the final results, I get to use my own sort of train of thought and sort of satisfy myself while satisfying sort of their vision of how they want guest interactions to be.
I think Zingerman's is a philosophy more than anything, a philosophical commitment to people and to excellence in interacting with people in a genuine fashion.
The philosophy is, you know, treat people really well, create clear expectations, model how you want people to behave, recognize and reward great performance, have an environment where people can grow and flourish, give them the tools that they need in order to do their jobs, and treat people like adults.
The people that I work with, I feel like I come here and people really care about me as a person, that my boss doesn't, you know, it's not this top-down management, then it's really them asking us, you know, what can I do for you? And that's really a feeling that I feel every day that I come here.
No matter what level of position you have here, we're all the same, we're all on the same team. As a leader, your role is to serve your staff and serve your coworkers and help each other rather than being the boss and giving orders and direction. We all help each other.
There's smart people all around you, and if you don't listen to everybody's ideas and make it a culture in which people feel good about coming forth with their ideas, that you end up missing out on a lot of great things.
It's a welcoming environment. Everyone is on your team. Like, they're rooting for you to be successful, and they set you up to be successful.
To me, Zingerman's is opportunity. It gives me the chance to do the best I can do every day and really educate people on really giving great service and eating amazing food. And I get to impact a bunch of people during the holiday in a positive way, and I feel really proud of that.
We all focus on different subcategories of food and making people feel good through food, but I think that's what the main idea is.
For that vision to be successful, none of us can get there alone. It depends on us all getting there together.
It's not only making this really amazing food, but it's creating an exceptional experience that people coming in the doors will just go, wow. So that's Zingerman's. It's not only the deli and then the businesses that have started from there, but it's an amazing experience.
Hi, everybody. I'm going to forego most of our history because y'all know me and we don't have a lot of time left, and I'm going to not waste your morning by repeating what you already know. And if you don't know our history, it's in the books. What do you notice in the film? People, very good. It's very observant. What else? Don't say food next. Okay. What else?
Smiles.
Smiles. What else?
Definitely.
Family in a good way.
Philosophy.
Yeah. I had the other one. It was the family in a not so happy way.
I said philosophy.
Yeah, a lot of philosophy. Is interesting that Erin Dion used that term, and I think I agree with her. What else?
Engagement.
Yeah. Engagement.
It seemed like they couldn't really put their finger on it, but it was something that's good, that's happening, that continues to happen, but we can't really put a tangible, this is exactly it.
Yeah, it's actually, I don't know if you heard what Ron said, it's hard to put your finger on exactly one thing, and I would actually suggest that is the one thing.
Yeah, it is.
The one thing is there's no one thing.
It's respect.
It's all of it, and to be honest with you, that film exists because I got tired of trying to answer what the one thing is.
Right.
I'm not joking, and you'll notice that Paul and I aren't in there, which I like. Where are we in? Oh, I'm in, I don't say anything, but yeah. But we're not really in there, and I think that that's actually the point, Are you pointing to me, Roger? Or are you
trying to get Michelle?
Michelle, Roger needs you, but he's trying to be discreet, but I'm not. So I guess what we have a brief window today to talk about one of the many things that goes into making a positive culture. By the way, we remain and will always be imperfect. What today's talk is about beliefs. Some of you are already reading the new book. How many people are already reading the new book? Okay, just a few of you. So, your cousin's in there.
Yeah.
100 years ago, but yeah. So the new book came out a few months ago. It's probably, of all of them, and I learned a lot from all of them, I learned a really lot from this one. The part one of the book, which is on vision and values and mission and stuff, was mostly things that we were already doing at Zingerman's and me writing about it to share it with other people and with our own organization. Part two was a lot of that. Part three was stuff on managing ourselves that I was doing and that things I had struggled through and learned from those struggles and then sharing it with the organization and with the world. Part four, which is on beliefs and has the generosity, spirit of generosity essay that some of you heard me speak about in June. And it's got two essays on hope in the workplace, which actually is all of those, in my estimation, turned out to be particularly timely for the cultural times in which we're all living. But I learned the most because most of what's in there I barely thought about until 3 years ago. The beliefs that, so people have a lot of theories about why our organization is what it is. And to Ron's point, there's some truth to probably most of them. But one thing that I realized never comes up until now is no one ever really looked at our beliefs. Our beliefs about people, our beliefs about ourselves, our beliefs about the role of business, our beliefs about the world. Because the beliefs, it turns out, underlie everything. Okay, and what I want to share with you today, obviously, it's a 600-page book. We're not going to get through the whole thing in the next half hour. My email is ari@zingermans.com. My cards are out there, and I, as many of you know, welcome dialogue. I'm a little behind on email because I've been teaching every single day this week, so I need to catch up later today, hopefully. But anyway, I would welcome dialogue. Today is really meant to prompt conversation, not to end it. I'm not going to answer all the questions you have about your whole life, but hopefully I give you a little more insight into some that you haven't thought about before. I like to put y'all to work. Page 3 in your workbook. No PowerPoint today. For those of you who've never heard me speak, I have negative beliefs about PowerPoint. Oh, stay back, Roger. Y'all have pens? This is very old school. Mara's going to get pens.
What's a pen?
It's retro, very retro. So on page 3, here's what I want you to do. I'm gonna give you 3 minutes, I'm gonna give it 2 minutes because we're tight on time. Mara's got pens if you need one. If you raise your hand, she'll give it to you. I'm gonna give you 2 minutes, and what I want you to do is I want you to write down as many things as you possibly can that you believe about your business or your organization, or Sylvia, if I'm not working anywhere, write it about yourself. Okay, so it'll go like, I believe, I believe, I believe, and you'll say whatever you want to say. The faster you write, the more powerful the exercise. If you're not working anywhere, write about yourself. Are you clear on what I'm asking?
Yes.
If you're looking at me or the ceiling, you're not writing. faster you write, the better it works. The more you stop to think about it, the less effective it will be.
Just because you're the sponsor, don't mean you need a pen.
No, I got a pen.
He's like, I'm the sponsor, I don't have to do it.
I did it last time.
Well, do it about something else, man. Do it about your wife.
By the way, if you do use your cell phone during this event, you have to tweet or post something about what a great job Ari's doing.
Actually, you can do whatever you want. I'm an anarchist. I don't. The last thing I want to do is tell you what to do with your phone.
My Twitter is Rob Stevens.
Okay, if you're in a flow, keep going. If you're ready to pause, I'd like you to pair with somebody near you. It doesn't have to be anybody you previously knew in order to help Rob achieve what he's trying to do around connections. So you might have to like move your body in an odd angle in order to meet somebody else. And I'm going to give you about 4 minutes. You don't have to share everything if it's personal, but pair up and talk.
On the sales, I'm going to do it there too, but
Presenting and training, I used to believe that what you wanted to do when you were running a group was to wait until they had finished talking about all the important stuff they wanted to talk about and it got kind of quiet and then you would bring them back. But Maggie, Rob mentioned from Zing Train, who actually studied training, she knew a lot more, still knows a lot more than I do. She changed my beliefs about that because what she taught me is you cut them off at the point that the volume is the highest. Because if you wait till the peters like starts to peter out, half the room is already bored. Mm-hmm. So she changed my belief about that. So we'll come back to why this exercise is helpful. We have a limited window, so I'm gonna just dive right in. If you turn to page 4, I wanna talk to you about beliefs and how I got going on all this stuff. So like I said, we are highly imperfect. We'll always be highly imperfect. Probably 5 years ago, we were dealing with a particular quality issue that crossed the lines of a number of our businesses, right? So it wasn't just within one area, it was in like 5 or 6, and it was the same product, but it was being used in different places. And we did what we often do at Zingerman's with our, you know, we got a big organization, whatever it is, 700 people, I don't know, 9 businesses or 10 businesses. So we put together a lot of work groups. There's actually an essay in the back at near the end of the book about what we call 1+1 work, which is a whole nother subject, which is getting people involved in a second piece of running the organization aside from their main core work. So we put together this work group and we did all the things that typically would make a good work group work well. We had a diverse cross-section of people. Some of them were managing partners, so like literal equity owners. Some of them were newer employees. Some of them were frontline employees. A lot of them have been there a long time, so we knew we had pretty good values alignment, right? They wrote a vision, which anybody who knows about how we work knows that's an integral piece of our approach, is to write a vision of what success looks and feels like when you get to where you're going. So they did all of those good things, and it just wouldn't work. And I'm pushing them, I'm coaching them, I'm trying everything. I know it's not working, we're going on for months. Not working, I'm getting really frustrated. Anybody else here get frustrated? Okay, excellent. So around the time that I was getting frustrated, I happened to be reading, I read a lot if you didn't already know that, or if you look in the book, it's like every 4 lines there's another book recited. So I happened to be reading a book by Bob and Judith Wright called Transformed. Bob Wright is in Chicago. He actually wrote the foreword to the third book. If you look in the end notes of the third book, you'll learn about my life and how I met him, which is actually an interesting story for another time. But anyway, in that book, it was this cycle, which is at the top of page 4 in your workbook. That cycle, he can't remember where he learned it, so I don't know who to really give credit to, but I'm giving it to him because I learned it from him. That cycle changed my whole view on almost everything. And it's starting to have an impact on our organization in a meaningful way, but it's relatively new even to us because we've only been teaching it probably 6, 7, 8 months. And it turned into, as I said, a 600-page book. I'm gonna teach you to cycle right now. Where's the pen? So, here's the deal, man. We all have beliefs. I'm not talking about sports. I'm not talking about religion. And I am not definitely talking about politics. That's when people talk beliefs, those are the three areas that mostly come up. So this is all actually true in those areas too. Not really in, well, it's true in sports for the athletes, but actually you, when you're watching on TV, you have no influence. I don't want to bum you out. But like when you wear your lucky socks, it doesn't change anything. When he wore his, it actually did change it, and we could talk. No, I'm not joking. It could actually make a difference for the people on the field or on the court, but it doesn't go through the TV. But anyway, for the rest of our lives, we have beliefs. Beliefs about what? Beliefs about what to wear to a setting like this. Beliefs about is worth getting up in the morning or is not worth getting up in the morning to go learn something. Beliefs about what good coffee cake tastes like. Beliefs about reading. Beliefs about people, beliefs about the world, beliefs about Detroit, beliefs about Ann Arbor, beliefs about the anarchists, whatever it is, right? So based on our beliefs, we take action. You might not have realized it until today. I didn't really think about it until 2 or 3 years ago. But every action you and I take, every action is based on a belief. When you brush your teeth, it's not random. Somebody planted, and I share that belief, my uncle who was a dentist, I share that belief that it's appropriate dental hygiene and all my teeth falling out when I get older, so I brush my teeth. Every action we take is based on our beliefs, right? When you deal with somebody at work, the way you deal with them is based on what you believe. Based on the way we act and behave, other people around us will also form beliefs about us and about the issue or the work at hand. Okay? Based on their beliefs, of course, they're going to take action. And here's the funny thing. Their action almost always reinforces our initial belief. It's quite remarkable. Here's how it works in business. So let's say you have a business, like not you all because you're all here, but most of the business world at large doesn't really have a really strong positive belief in training. So if you don't, if you're the CEO, the manager, whatever, and you don't believe training is a very good idea, what sort of action will you take in your organization? Not training. Don't do any training. If you did do training, like government mandated training, what kind of energy would you have around it when it happened?
Low.
Very low. Based on all that, what sort of beliefs are the people in your organization going to form? Not important. What else? What about themselves?
Matter.
They don't matter. What about their future in your organization? Grim. Based on all of those beliefs, what sort of work they going to do when they show up? Not very good. And I'm the CEO. I go, it's a good thing we didn't spend any more time on that training. Look how bad they are. You're laughing, but this is actually one of the biggest problems in the economy. Now you have what we have, and many of you probably have. We believe super strongly in training. I don't know how many internal classes. We got 50, 60 internal classes on everything from personal finance to customer service, visioning, all sorts of stuff. That's the action we take. We schedule classes all the time. We're sending people to other seminars. We're doing all to give up. All our employees could get a free copy of the books, business books, whatever. Based on that action, what sort of beliefs do you think people in our organization generally form?
They matter.
They matter. What about their future? Could be really good, yeah. We believe in them. Based on all of that, what sort of things do you think they do when they come to work?
Awesome.
Good work. And I go, man, that training's fabulous. Here's the funny thing, which isn't that funny. It's exactly the same people in both scenarios. And no offense, there's two great people that I love working with sitting in the back of the room that came down with me this morning. But no offense to all of the great people we got. We aren't really any different than the people in the bad organizations. It's just people don't do well in unhealthy ecosystems. Okay? So beliefs are driving everything that we have going on in our lives. Right? There's another little stage in here that I want to share with you. It's right in here. Sorry, Greg. Can you see that? So this is the stage where we filter information, like polarized sunglasses. We filter out the what we don't want getting in, and we take in what we want. What do we want? We want to take in the stuff that supports what we already believe, and we dismiss the stuff that doesn't fit with what we already believe. Everybody's doing this all day long. So in that first scenario with the CEO who doesn't believe in training, it's not like no employee ever learned anything, but when they do, they go, oh, you know, her father's in business, it's kind of, she doesn't really count. And in our organization, come on, be real, it's not like we never sent an employee to training and they didn't do anything or quit the next day or whatever, but we go, well, whatever, I mean, they're having a rough time in their life. What we allow in
is what supports what we already believe. What doesn't fit our beliefs, we get rid of. Okay, remember 9/11? Just had the anniversary. Remember when we went to war with Iraq? You might have blocked it out by now. Remember when President Bush got up and he said that Saddam Hussein was behind 9/11, and that's why we had to go to war. You might not remember, but like, I don't know, 2 years later, he got up again on TV and he announced that they had realized through more research that actually Saddam Hussein was not behind 9/11. He happened to have done a lot of other bad things, so we had to go to war with him. Anyway, it was kind of too late by then. But anyway, he announced that the president announced from the stage on TV Saddam Hussein was not behind 9/11. They did a survey study of people and their beliefs. Only 4% of the people who believed him the first time changed their beliefs after he announced that he was initially wrong. They continue to believe Saddam Hussein was behind 9/11, even though the person who had told them that in the first place changed his mind based on research and data. Is this making sense? I mean, it doesn't make sense, but does it make sense? Okay, so this is really what's going on all the time. So when you start to study beliefs, and I'm certainly not the first person to do it, William James, who's often called the father of modern psychology, said belief creates the actual fact. What we believe is creating what's happening. I used to focus, before I learned this, like always over here, how do I get them to change? What I've learned over the last few years is probably 75-80% of the time, it's what I believe. If you change your belief, the whole cycle changes. If there's somebody you're having a hard time working with, you could follow the cycle. Okay? So in our limited window today, I'm going to move to the middle of the page. Where do you think beliefs come from?
Everywhere.
Everywhere. That's a, can you be more general?
TV,
ideas,
experience.
Yeah, a lot comes when we're little. It comes from people we trust. And when you're a little child, we didn't know enough when you're really little to know that your parents were wrong a lot of the time. So we believe all of it. Then we get older and then we argue with them. But anyway, we're taking in beliefs from people we trust. It could have been your best friend on the playground. It could have been a mentor you had. It could have been an amazing teacher you had, a minister, your grandmother, your grandfather, a book. I learned a lot from books. Could be people you never met. By the way, the whole version of the American West actually never existed. They made it up for the movies, and all of us watch the movies, and then we act based on that movie, and Ronald Reagan created his whole career based on something that never existed. This is the truth. Because, by the way, the past, G.K. Chesterton, English writer, said the past is not what it once was. Because this cycle works in reverse, too. We filter the information from history that doesn't fit with what we believe now. I don't have time to get into it, but this is a very interesting thing. So beliefs are coming in all over the place. So Maggie at Zingtrain talks a lot about what she calls unconscious competence. You know what unconscious competence means in a skill? Anybody?
It's innate. You'll just do it by habit.
Yeah, I wouldn't say it's innate, but you do it by habit. So I don't know that you're born with it, but you...
Ingrained.
Yeah, you do it in your sleep. I guess it's innate. So basically, you're paying no attention. Driving would be one of them. It's not a bad thing. Breathing. Okay? Like when I say it, you're thinking about it. But before I say it, you haven't given one iota of thought probably to your breathing unless you have a cold and you're congested. So I would suggest when you're unconsciously competent, you just basically do it. You don't think about it. You don't pay attention to it. What I'm going to suggest to you is that most people are unconsciously competent about their own belief system. Like there might be a few key things you're paying attention to, but most of what we believe we don't pay attention to. Carl Jung, who you might have heard of, said, until you make the unconscious conscious, it will direct your life and you will call it fate.
It is true. And so my hope with this is to give people a chance to realize what their beliefs are. That exercise you just did, which is in the book, which I stole the name or borrowed the name from the 1950s radio show, this I believe, which was a very interesting show. But that exercise actually works. As simplistic as it seems, the faster you write, your the speed of the writing keeps your brain from overriding what you really believe. The slower you move, the more you're going to filter it to be what you think you should believe, or I should say what you believe you should believe. Is this making any sense?
Yeah.
Okay, so moving quickly, the bottom of the page talks about alignment. There's a whole essay on it in the book. What I started to realize is that people have beliefs that are not aligned with what they're trying to do in their lives, and this, of course, causes problems. Anybody driven their car when it was out of alignment? What happens? Shakes, noisy, wears the tires down. Can you do it? You can. But if you stop holding tight to the wheel and you stop paying attention, what's going to happen? You veer off course. And if you're close to the wall, you're in big trouble. It's the same with your beliefs. So metaphorically, I started to actually look at beliefs. We deal a lot with food, obviously. I started to look at beliefs as the root system of our lives. You don't see it, but what comes up above ground, the action, is always directly a result of the root system. If you have beliefs that are not aligned with the vision that you have for your life, if you have beliefs that are not aligned with the work you're trying to do, it's like driving your car out of alignment. It's always going to be stressful and it's going to be very difficult. So a common belief, I'll just share an example of this that's very common in our industry. Rob talked about the food we work with. So people open in our industry regularly and they have a wonderful vision about amazing, great, traditional, handmade food. They're all for it. There's a problem they struggle with, and I don't mean it's ill-intended, it's not, but they have a belief that great food should be really inexpensive. And that's a fabulous belief because, as we know from what you heard this morning, there's a lot of people going hungry out in the community, and that's a big problem. But the problem is you can't make great handmade food using artisan ingredients, pay the people who do it a moderately livable wage, pay benefits for them, and have it be cheap. It doesn't add up. It's out of alignment. And so when you're out of alignment, what do? When they have that belief, what do when they open? They don't charge enough. What's the customer believe? They believe what was being charged is what the price should be, because y'all don't really know what prices are. You just get used to it, and then you believe that's normal, like what y'all pay for cars or phones. You don't even think about it. They take action then, and the price is set at that level, and then all these people go out of business. 90% of people in the food business go under in the first year. Farmers cannot make a living. Everybody wants local agriculture, but nobody wants to pay the farm. If the farmer made 25 bucks an hour, you'd be paying, and I would be paying, and I think it actually would be good, but you'd be paying 15, 20 bucks for a tomato. If the farmer does it for free on their day off and they got a different job to support themselves, it's really cheap. So my point is not necessarily what the price of food needs to be, but if you have things in your life that are out of alignment with what you're trying to do, you want an inclusive workplace, but you actually believe most of your employees don't know what they're doing. Commonly held problem, common problem. CEO believes in engagement. This is the buzzword now in the business world. CEO believes in engagement, but not from these people. It's out of alignment. It won't work. Okay? So what I want to do is move you to the next. I'm going to tell you one quick story that just to illustrate what happens with beliefs when you shift your belief, how much things look really differently, right? So we have my girlfriend and I have I had a corgi. Does anybody know what corgis are?
Yeah. Okay.
So I had a corgi for 17 years, and she died a year and 3 months ago. It sucks. And my girlfriend got us a new puppy almost a year ago for my birthday. And we named her Bean Sprout from Jelly Bean. Anyway, so Sprout is a very good dog. Corgis are super smart and they're very fun and very cute. And she's a great dog. And there's a couple weird things, but there's one in particular weird thing that started to happen, which is when Tammy or I or whoever, but in this case I'm watching, so it's Tammy, takes the broom out of the closet and starts sweeping, Sprout goes ballistic. Of course, I tried logic on her, but that didn't work. So like going, Sprout, it's just a broom. She didn't go, oh, I didn't realize that, thank you. So I'm like, what is going on with this, man? It's like a broom. Like, what is it? Like in our world, you're like, what could possibly be making this dog go ballistic? But because I was focusing on beliefs, like all of a sudden it struck me. See, you and I see Tammy holding this broom and we go, it's a woman holding a broom. But if you're a little corgi puppy who's very loyal to your owner, it looks very much like the broom got a hold of your owner. And no matter how she tries to get away, it won't let go. When you change your belief, life looks a lot different. Okay, and just to be obvious about what's going on in the society with the shootings, if you already believed, which I don't, but if you already believed that African American people were more prone to commit crimes, the shootings are evidence that that was the case. If you believe what I believe, and probably most of you believe, it's the 180 degree opposite. So the data is the same, but the beliefs alter drastically how we perceive what's going on, and then our actions follow from those beliefs. Is this making any sense? Okay, so let's look at the next page, which is another little exercise. I'm gonna give you two more minutes, and I want you to think about something you're struggling with in your life. It could be at work, it could be at home, it could be with your dog. Could be your organization, could be a relationship at work or out of work, and I'm gonna have you do that same exercise. I want you to list as many things you believe about this situation or the person or the people involved as you possibly can in 2 minutes. Are you clear on what I'm asking? Pick anything, don't struggle with it. If you're worried about it, I believe you're overthinking it. Anything you're struggling with, could be big, small. Try not to pick like the Detroit Tigers or something like that. The faster you write, the more you'll learn. Thank you. So if we had more time, I'd have you pair up again, but I'm going to let you do that on your own with somebody else in your life. If you're in a flow, by the way, keep writing. I don't mind multitasking. I don't have any bad beliefs about multitasking, despite the rest of the world's currently down on it. I look at it as you're being more efficient. But anyways, on the next page, as I started to study beliefs more and more, I began to break beliefs out into the three broad categories that you will see on page 6 in your workbook. Negative beliefs, neutral beliefs, and positive beliefs. Here's the kind of obvious conclusion I came to after having never thought about it before. And once I say it, you'll realize it's pretty obvious to you too. Neutral beliefs don't do a whole lot. Negative beliefs create negative outcomes. Positive beliefs create positive outcomes. You cannot get positive outcomes from negative beliefs. It's impossible. You can create a lot of energy. You can make action happen. You can create riots, tear down buildings, overthrow dictators. It's not often bad, but if you don't have positive beliefs about what comes after, nothing generative, sustainable will come from it. You can get somebody fired, but you're not going to make a good organization. Negative beliefs lead to negative outcomes. Positive beliefs lead to positive outcomes. We all have some negative beliefs, and we all have some positive beliefs, but I'm just going to tell you, I realized from doing this, if I'm holding negative beliefs and you follow that cycle, it will not end well. If you have negative beliefs about an employee that works with you, you either need to change the beliefs or you need to let them go. Most people hear this, and the most common question that they ask is, how do I, like, let's say you got somebody that you're in your family or like you work with them, and like you could see that they're doing this cycle, like how do you get them to change their beliefs? I'm like, you're missing the point. The point is not getting them to change their beliefs. It's like the point is, what are my beliefs and how do I alter my beliefs to be more aligned with what I'm trying to do and with my values? Okay, if you have negative beliefs about your significant other or your child, it won't work. There's a whole essay in the book because I realize that everybody wants to make a great, healthy organization. You can't build one on negative beliefs. Sorry. You can get people fired up, but I'm going to tell you that even competition is actually, I don't know how to do it on the football field without it, but in business is not the football field, and there's metaphors that are shared, but we're not trying to beat anybody. I'm trying to help everybody. Because I started to look at business much more as an ecosystem. If the root system is healthy, the soil is the culture. If the soil is healthy and the root system is healthy and you plant appropriate seeds in it, the odds of getting great fruit up top are like 98%. If the soil is unhealthy, the culture is unhealthy, and the root system is either negative or very shallow, the odds are very high you're going to get very poor quality product growing above the surface. Is this making any sense? So what could happen from this exercise real quickly? I'll tell you a couple stories just because they've happened. One happened earlier this week. A woman came when I spoke at Zing Train about this before the book came out last year, and she talked to me like 2 weeks later, and she's like, I did that exercise which y'all just did. And she said, I have a daughter in high school, like 15 or must be like under 16, because she was picking her up every day from school. And she goes, you know, grades are really important, right, like everybody else. And she's not doing that well in school. She's like, every day I pick her up from school, within 5 minutes we're in another argument about her grades. I don't know if anybody else has been there. So she's telling me the story, and she goes, after that talk, I changed my beliefs. I'm like, what did you do? She goes, I changed my beliefs to be that my relationship with my daughter is more important than her grades. She said within 2 days, the conversation tone changed 180 degrees. Here's another one from Monday, from Tuesday. Did this exercise at a zinc train seminar. Woman who, her and her husband own a very cool business in Nashville called Biscuit Love. Very good name. She did this. Asked people what they had learned. She raised her hand, first one up. She goes, oh my God, I just realized, like, I have the belief that managers, so they keep, they're growing really fast and they can't get enough good managers. She goes, I realized I have the belief that managers and leaders are born, not trained. I have the opposite belief. Everybody can learn to lead. If you believe that it's a natural skill, you're gonna keep looking and you're gonna keep not training and you're gonna keep not finding them. So this has very, very big impacts. Thomas Merton, some of you will know of, he said, where minds are full of hatred and where imaginations dwell on cruelty, torment, punishment, revenge, and death, inevitably there will be violence and death. Now, that's extreme, but this is going on in negative workplaces all over the world. Because people got negative beliefs about their coworkers, about their departments, about their boss, about business. I grew up with very negative beliefs about business. I'm from a family of academics, doctors, lawyers, dentists, that is clueless about business. Paul, my partner, who Rob mentioned, grew up here in Detroit. I'm a Chicago kid, so I actually have neutral beliefs about Detroit. Nothing bad, nothing good. It's not where I'm from. I don't spend a lot of time here. He's from here and is very, like many of you, bonded to the city. His grandfather had a business that was very community-minded, and so Paul's grandfather taught him, and he taught me, that business, nothing negative about it, business is just a tool. It's not business that's negative, it's what you do with it. And just like you could hit somebody in the head with a hammer and harm them, or you could build a house with the same exact hammer for a family that didn't have a house, it's not the hammer. And the same with business, okay? So the key of this really is just to become mindful of what we believe, because what we believe is having a major impact on what's going on around us. And we can blame other people, but what I'm gonna suggest is it's mostly starting with us. Now, does having positive beliefs mean there's no problems? No. There are lots of challenges. You just heard about, what's it called here, Second City Harvest?
Forgotten Harvest.
So, and we have food gathers, which we started in 1988. It was Paul's idea. So here's the reality of 1988, and here was 1990, I think I read. So, a negative belief about the situation would have been, there's a lot of people going hungry, the system sucks, this is crazy, this is horrible, people should do something. That's a negative belief. What do you get from that? Anger, rage, and a lot of conversation. And nothing. Here's Paul's belief, which was a positive belief, and the same for the woman who started it here. People are going hungry, this is terrible, we could do something about it. The problem is the same. It's just the beliefs about the problem. So I'm not saying Pollyanna. I'm not saying gloss over the issues. We embrace the issues. It's just positive beliefs about the outcome. So an employee who's struggling is not a loser. It's a good human being that's having a hard time for some reason. I don't know what it is. In the end, we may not be able to help them, but let's try. Okay, Oscar Wilde said, we're all laying in the same gutter, but some of us are looking at the stars. Matisse said, there's always flowers for those who choose to see them. And I'm guessing you all are some of those people, or you wouldn't have got up early this morning to come to this talk. Let's pause for a minute or two of questions, because I know we're tight on time. Yes, Sylvia.
What kind of work do you do when you decide to change? I'm totally bought into the subject here. And the part that I think is...
You believe in this belief cycle.
I believe in this belief cycle.
Okay.
And I will affirm your belief in this belief cycle. So what do you do when you decide, okay, I realize my belief is actually the you know, beginning of this negative cycle, I'm going to change it.
Right.
You know, that work to me is not easy all the time. What are some of the things you do?
Well, there's an essay with a whole recipe for how to do it. It starts with what you just did, which is owning the issue. And realizing that you want to do work, and then starting, we all get, when we have problematic beliefs, we're all getting something out of the problem. Like, by continuing to blame others, we don't have to do anything. So we're all getting some out of it. So the next thing is to start to look at the equation. Sometimes you find what you're getting from it is fine. Like, I mean, here's the true story. I had a number of muscular issues without getting into all my health history. I run every day. And 3 or 4 years ago, I started having problems like that seemed to be my knee, but it turned out it wasn't my knee. It's just the muscles around my knee contracting in weird ways that were causing pain. So while they were dealing with that, and by the way, it took like 20 doctors to figure this out, and it was the massage therapist that figured it out, just saying. But anyway, I'm not down on doctors. But anyway, so I started wearing a knee brace, you know, just like a rubber one, right? So, you know, because it seemed to help, I don't know. So like, you know, this 4 years later, man, I mean, I run every day. The truth is, I don't think I really need the knee brace anymore. And when I first started, it bugged the hell out of me. Now, like, I'm so used to it that it actually scares me to take it off. So I was like, well, I have negative beliefs about it, but then I was like, it doesn't matter. Like, there's no harm caused by me continuing to wear the knee brace. It gives me less to worry about when I'm running, so I just leave it on. So sometimes you find that there isn't really any huge negative outcome from the belief. But then you're walking through, if you're really doing the work, where did the belief come from? Many times the beliefs that we have came from people to whom those beliefs were appropriate at the time that they had them. So when I looked at my family, right? So I grew up in a worrying, highly critical, high achieving family. Anybody else? Okay, excellent. This is universal. There's no age, ethnicity, gender, race that constricts that belief. It goes everywhere. So I've met with this woman who's Vietnamese American the other day. She's telling me about her family and the pressure she's got. She's 21, just finished school. I'm like, sounds exactly like what I grew up with. Okay, anyway, so here, then I'm like, okay, where did they get all that from? My grandparents came from Eastern Europe, where being Jewish was like about as bad as you could have, and anytime something went wrong, that's where they went and destroyed the houses, burned everything, whatever. Then they came here. My grandfather came in the middle of World War I. He would tell us stories about the skies being red from the bombs, and they escaped from that. Then they got here, and then 12 years later, they had the Depression. Then they made it through that, and then they looked in the newspaper and found out about the Holocaust, and everybody that they knew was being had been put to death. I'm like, huh, wonder where they got these worrisome, slightly cynical about the world beliefs. Now, those beliefs were appropriate in their setting because it created appropriate self-defense against what was going on. But fortunately, thank God, I am not living in that setting. If I continue to hold the beliefs that they gave me, not ill-intended, I will create negative outcomes because I'm not living in Eastern Europe, World War I, the Depression, and the Holocaust. And I'm not saying those were unimportant or there weren't huge issues around it, but I'm not there. So it's choosing the beliefs that are appropriate for where you are right now. Yes, sir.
Since beliefs are so core, and some can be founded on absolutely nothing.
Absolutely.
So how do one begin to diffuse core beliefs that are based on nothing?
Yeah, so it's the same stuff. So Anthony's asking about core beliefs. So the core beliefs, so here's how I look at it, right? So values for me, which are very important, are also beliefs, but they're the ones that are ethically based, about human dignity, etc. I'm not suggesting you would change those, but the other beliefs can be changed. By the way, racism is just a negative belief. Sexism is a negative belief. The belief women can't do X, negative belief. And by the way, when people have the belief that you can assign characteristics to an entire group of people, I believe that's fallacious and creates nothing but trouble. Why? Because I believe everyone is a unique, creative human being, unreplicated anywhere in the world. But when we assign characteristics to groups, it's doomed. Because here's the other thing. Everybody's been trained to believe that hierarchy makes sense. I believe hierarchy is unnatural. If you assign characteristics to groups and you believe in hierarchy, it's either your group's better than mine or my group's better than yours, and that's doomed.
How does belief equate with passion or commitment for work?
I would say the passion is the action.
And do you think that then positive beliefs could inspire passion and commitment to your colleagues?
Absolutely, because if you don't believe in your employees, what's going to happen? Follow the cycle. If you don't believe in what you're doing, what's going to happen? Most of the world, by the way, doesn't believe in the work they're doing. most of the people working, their boss doesn't actually believe in them. Most of the world has negative beliefs about the world. See, Ann, don't run me over. He sees me running off. It's a narrow road.
All right, one more question.
Okay, yeah. Two, Jeff and Ron.
All right.
Well, thank you so much. I mean, number one, thank you. I can't believe.
By the way, page 7 has a lot of our organizational beliefs versus what I would suggest are the commonly held ones out in the world, and you'll see in 2 minutes what the difference.
I've been privileged to hear you do this kind of stuff a few times, and this is really, really super effective today. It's amazing what gets through my brain on 3 hours sleep right now. Thank you. And I'm bringing my team to your dinner, so everybody else is trying to get the rest of those seats. I want to talk about what this cycle is so huge. I believe that one leads to the other, leads to the other. We'll define it. But I see disconnects between these things. I know I have disconnects between my beliefs and my actions.
Okay.
I think you got a book for that about managing yourself.
Well, what I'm going to suggest is that when you get better at this, you start to realize the beliefs that you believe you should have is not the same as what you really believe. Okay, by the way, if you clip a weed at the surface line, what will happen? Remember, the root system is the beliefs. If you clip the weed, you have negative beliefs, you get weeds. You clip the weed at the surface line, what's going to happen?
Well, I got all kinds of great stuff though. I got positive beliefs, but I think my actions don't,
Okay, what I'm going to suggest is this works. So I'm going to tell you that you have other beliefs that you aren't conscious of yet that are driving the other action.
Yeah, thank you.
So if you clip the weed at the surface line, what happens? It grows back. So this is why, when companies send people to diversity training for 2 hours, they learn what words not to say. But under pressure, they just go right back because the beliefs are still there. People don't change their belief because they got sent to a mandatory training. And I'm not opposed to the training. I'm just saying the beliefs of deep roots, 30, 40 years of deep, we held beliefs from the community they grew up in, wherever it was, about whatever it was. Look at the Middle East. Those beliefs are not going away because somebody from the United States showed up and said, oh, I think it's different. You gotta let go of those beliefs to get different outcomes. Ron.
Yeah, so let's say you have a negative belief and you know that.
I do or you do?
No, okay, let's say. I do.
We both probably do. But
okay.
So I'm clear on what you're saying.
Yeah, no, uh-huh. So let's say I have a negative belief. And I don't want negative outcomes, so I want to change that.
Okay.
And so I'm asking for you, when you're looking at how to change your belief, is it almost like going through a viewfinder of slides to determine this is the perspective belief that I feel is going to be best?
Yeah, it's the same question Sylvia asked. So, again, and I'm not trying to be short-circuited, but there's a whole recipe in the book about how I figured out, this is what I believe you need to do to change them. If you want to be super quick, just for a role play, like Rob suggested, just immediately adopt 180 degree opposite belief and see what happens.
Right.
If you want to do super quick, I don't think that in the long run that's going to change it, but it's like a little experiment you could conduct. Ultimately, you need to do some homework to understand where the beliefs came from and make a mindful choice. Free choice about beliefs is the taproot. It's the main root. Most of the world doesn't even realize that they could change their beliefs. They think they're genetic. Dude, you're not born with beliefs. Beliefs came from your parents, your grandparents, the news, the movies, your favorite rock star, your favorite rapper, your favorite movie star, somebody, your minister, somebody gave you beliefs. You might like them, run with it. But if they're not working, or you realize they're actually out of alignment with where you want to go, you have the individual freedom and power to choose your beliefs. It's a big deal. Last quote, and then I'm going to get out of the way. This is from Isaac Asimov, the science fiction writer. Anybody ever read his stuff? I used to read a lot of science. I don't read it anymore, but when I was 14, I used to read a ton of science fiction. Turns out all these science fiction writers, most of them, were very radical thinkers, and the way they could convey their radical thoughts was to put them on other planets. Because nobody could critique them anymore because it was it didn't actually exist. So I read his biography 2 years ago. It was quite interesting. He said, to me, it seems to be important to believe people to be good, even if they tend to be bad, because your own joy and happiness in life is increased that way. And the pleasures of the belief outweigh the occasional disappointment. To be a cynic about people works just the other way around and makes you incapable of enjoying the good things.
So obviously I got a lot more to tell you, but I'm gonna get out the way and go out there, and if you want a book, I'll sign it, and if you don't, I'll say hi anyway. And my email's ari@zingermans.com. Thank you all for what you do. Thank you, Bob.
Thanks, Ari. Hey, we've got 25 books to give away. If you hear your name, come on up and get a book. And if you don't, go out there and buy one. Pam Palmon. Derek Bird. April Anderson. Michelle DeMercuro. Marianne Lisman. Woo! Ranam Kazaha. Man, that's bad. David Elkus, Linda Van Acker, Drew Patrick, woo, class of 36, Chris Lum, Jasper Hanafee, Marianne Wright, Charlie Moret, Carol Lieberman Rich, Caroline, Michelle Anderson, Brunella, Cynthia Zimber, Blanca Fable, Tony Nestro, Lee Berry, George Azrak, Narendra Kumar, Steve Burns, Chris Tarnacki. That's it. Thank you very much, everybody.
Yeah, there you go.
Thank you.
So we've got some Arras too.
Anybody wants to stay for the role playing?
I think there's,
stand up.